Most of the lead compounds are sparingly soluble or even insoluble in water, with only a few exceptions such as lead to acetate, lead to chloride, and lead to nitrite. In fact, there is some analytical technique based on the insolubility of the lead salt for determining the content of lead to ions in solution. For example, the gravimetric determination of lead to ions can be easily done by employing a switchable precipitating solution such as potassium chromide. In this way, it is possible to obtain a coarse and easily filterable precipitate of lead to chromide that, after being conveniently dry and weighted, it will serve to calculate the mass percentage of lead in the solution. One important thing to remark is that aqueous chemistry of lead is mainly based on the oxidation state 2+, whilst 4+ ions are unstable. This is an important fact because redox reactions of lead in aqueous solution are of minor importance. Additionally, salts of lead in oxidation state 2+ are also stable with respect to hydrolysis, while the ion lead 4+ doesn't exist in solution. This behavior contrasts with the lower stability of tin 2 salts, which are readily oxidized or hydrolyzed to form different species, as it is shown in the following equilibrium for tin dichloride. In order to maintain a clear solution of tin dichloride, it is necessary a solution hydrolyzed with hydrochloric acid, which would maintain the equilibrium toward the left-hand side according to the well-known Le Chatelier principle. In the following demonstration, we are going to observe the limited solubility of lead salt in water, specifically lead iodide, through an experiment that is commonly known as the golden rain. This demonstration is a very common experiment in chemistry classes, which consists on mixing both a potassium iodide and a lead nitrite solutions, which react through a double displacement reaction to give a bright yellow precipitate of lead iodide according to the following equation. Again, it is necessary to remember about the toxicity of lead and specifically those soluble salts which are extremely toxic. So please don't try to manage these chemicals without the adequate protection. And if you finally try the experiment, remember to dispose of lead compounds at hazardous waste facilities, as we will describe later, and wash your hands thoroughly when you finish the demonstration. For making the solutions, obviously we have employed deionized water in order to avoid the presence of some common anions which are in tap water, such as sulfides, carbonates, or chlorides, which will lead to the formation of insoluble salts and make both solutions cloudy. And additionally, we are going to add some drops of one molar solution of hydrochloric acid in order to avoid any possible precipitation of lead carbonate, just in case there is still some carbonate present or some carbon dioxide absorbed by the solution. In fact, lead carbonate is prepared industrially by passing carbon dioxide through a dilute solution of lead acetate. The concentration of both solutions is the same, 0.3% by weight volume, and we will mix approximately the same volume of both solutions. However, remember that the molecular weight of lead nitrite is higher than potassium iodide, so the former will be the limiting region of the reaction, whilst the latter will be in excess. In this way, we ensure that all lead present in the solution react conveniently. Let's first add the solution of lead to nitrate drops wide to the solution of potassium iodide. So you can observe how a beautiful yellow precipitate is formed when the drop comes in contact with the solution. However, the solid redissolves when we stir the mixture because it is slightly soluble. Let's continue by adding a couple of drops more. You can see the bright yellow color. Let's now pour all the remaining lead to nitrite solution very fast over the potassium iodide solution. Now, in order to appreciate the beauty of these yellow crystals, what we are going to do is heating the mixture in a vat which has a temperature of about 80 Celsius degrees until it completely dissolves. When the solid has been dissolved, it produces a colorless solution again. And now we are going to let it cool down again. The drop in temperature will cause the formation of very pure and larger crystals of lead iodine that will produce a more glittering and shimmering effect, what is usually referred as golden rain. The process of crystallization is something slow and it can last for up to an hour as the crystal comes back out the solution. The longer the cooling process, the larger the crystals form, and therefore you will appreciate better the beauty of the demo. Now we can observe the precipitation of the crystal, and you can understand why this demo is called the golden rain. The crystals are moving around due to convection current originated. Once we have finished the experiment, let's filter off the precipitate by gravity and dispose the mother liquor in a toxic waste container. But not only it is necessary that the yellow lead iodine precipitate was conveniently disposed, but also we need to remove any lead content that can be still in the mother liquor or the rest of container and glassware that were kept in contact with the lead during the demo. In order to do that, we are going to employ a saturated solution of baking soda and let's add it to the mother liquor. As you can see, a white precipitate is formed, which indicates that there still was some lead present, because also lead iodine is insoluble given its solubility constant value, there is a very few remaining lead still dissolved. So, by formation of lead carbonate, which is a much more insoluble salt, we ensure that all lead is removed.